Welcome to our today's live talk. Wyclef Jean, the fall and the rise of a refugee, here at Bread and Butter in Berlin. My name is Tyron Ricketts, I'm your host. And because we don't have a lot of time, let's just introduce the guests real quick. Please give it up for Wyclef Jean. What up? Have a seat, my friend.
Yeah.
Would you care for some water?
Man, I was in the club last night, Pearl.
I turned up
so much, I felt like I was Future or something. Okay. Can't keep up with these kids. I don't know how they do that, man.
It's an age thing, my man. I know exactly what you're talking about. It's been a while since we met the last time. We spoke about it briefly before, like when you released your first Carnival album. I came to New York. So it's been 20 years.
Yeah.
20 years. I want to know, who have you become?
Man, that's a good question.
Thank you.
Well, I think 20 years I become a father, you know, and I have a 12-year-old daughter. So remember, like, on Ready or Not, when I was like, Ready or Not, here I come. And I was like, yo, now that I escape, sleep, walk, awake, those who can relate know the world ain't cake. Jail bars ain't golden gates. Those who fake, they break. It's like, you know, you coming in the game, you want to be heard, you know what I'm saying? And I think, you know, after being heard, you figure out, you know, what really matters. So it's sort of like, it's a good thing to now, I don't work for myself no more, you know what I mean? It's like, I'm working for a beautiful girl that's 12 years old. Mm-hmm. And that's a great feeling, you know what I mean? Yeah.
So that changed you majorly,
yeah,
I guess.
Yeah, big time.
So I guess that brings me to the next question. What have you learned in the last 20 years?
Well, really, so when we started off with the Fugees is short for refugees. And the movement of the refugees, actually, we started it in 1992. So 1992, 93. The first Fugee album is actually called Blunted on Reality. We have a big relationship with Germany because this is the market that actually broke the Fugees with a record called Fugee La that exploded. And, yo, we was coming to Germany when hip-hop, like, wasn't even big. I'm talking about the promoters would put all of us in some big factory and then just start playing music. That's how far back we go. So to see how hip hop has grown in Germany also is pretty incredible. But it's sort of like the topic of the refugee topic is like so, I call it like mainstream right now, right? But this is a topic that's been really going on. We've been talking about this like, you know, since 92. Because coming from Haiti, getting to Miami, you know, I've had families that had to get on boats, man, and literally tried to make it over to Miami. Some made it alive and some didn't. So the idea of why we created the Fugees, being short for refugees, was we wanted to have a different, people to have a different perception of like what refugees were.
Yeah. What do you say, you succeeded?
Well, I mean, we're optimistic, you know what I mean, at the end of the day, because you're going to have, people are going to have opinions and they're going to have strong opinions, as they should, or you would have a boring world. But at the same time, I feel like true compassion, humanity, you know, peace, no war, I just feel like that's always the best solution to most things.
It feels like right now is a good time to maybe revive that whole refugee consciousness, because I mean the world is in a state where a lot of people are actually running away, but we might be able to touch that topic.
Okay, well, I mean, it's definitely everywhere we go, people say, yo, Fugee short for refugees, you know, how do you feel about refugees? And I say, man, just go back to 92. The best way to explain it to you, man, I didn't meet my parents till I was 10 years old. They left me in a small village when I was one. My daddy got to America, and then 10 years later, they came back for me. And the idea of opportunity is what create all of us here. So if we all didn't have opportunities, we wouldn't be here. You dig?
What do you say that experience that you made, you know, did that spark your creativity? Was that like a driving force?
Well, the hardest thing I ever did in my life, besides losing my dad, was trying to become the president of Haiti. I can hear my rap friends like, that nigga crazy. You know what I mean? Like, yeah, that nigga crazy.
So at the end of the day, though, it was like, so after I did like Hips Don't Lie for Shakira, and, you know, it was like, I was like, man, after you do 100 million worth of albums worth of work, then now you have an earthquake. 250,000 people under the rubble. And people be like, yo, what made you sacrifice everything to go do that? Because politics is a dirty game. They could have lynched you alive, man. You know, I said, because I'll always be able to come back to music. You see what I'm saying? Look, I'm swag, I'm Versace'd up. I look like the chocolate lover, you know what I mean? That's me, baby, you feel me? Brooklyn in the house. But I'll never be able to go back to that time of the earthquake when 250 people was under the rubble. If I didn't go and try to pick up that girl from under the rubble, save somebody, if I wasn't able to pick up those dead bodies and help bring them to the cemetery, help lay people to rest, then I wouldn't really be here. Because for me, that time, I can't go back. I always knew I could do music and come back to music. But when people are in need, you have to help right when they're in need. And it's a crazy thing because you literally have to sacrifice everything and decide that you're gonna do that. But to me, that was one of the best things that my daughter's generation, I mean, they're 12, they're 13, you know, when they FaceTime me, they're singing, if I was president, I'd get elected on Friday, you know? And it's like, they ain't singing Ready or Not. It's this is the generation. So they're very conscious in their thoughts. Yeah,
that's good. I had the honor to work with Mr. Harry Belafonte in New York for 2 years.
Uh-huh.
And he always used his celebrity to actually change society, you know? Yeah. And I mean, you've been involved politically. I want to know from you, in a current political situation, also in America, how important would you say it is for artists to get involved?
Well, Harry Belafonte is one of my mentors. And any move that I'm going to do, I always like, Harry will tell you it is, you know? Another person I spent a short time with face-to-face was Nelson Mandela. Mm-hmm. So for me, you know, those men are very, very important. But like I said, politics is a tricky game. You know what I mean? It's a very tricky game, and you don't know who's hitting you. You know what I mean? It's like when it's a drive-by in the hood, it's clear. You know what I'm saying? Like, you're like, yo, dude coming with the mask. He lay low up in the car. You see them coming, you know? With politics, you don't see nothing, man. All you see is, like, invisible. Ah! Ah! You know, you're like, whoa, what I do here? What I do here? You know?
But and, I mean, that's when you become a politician. But as an artist, you reach so many people nowadays. I mean, isn't it a political statement just to be an artist nowadays?
It's tricky, right? Because artists are emotional. Like, if you're going to step in that field, learn the policies, learn the legislation, because are they going to use your sound bites for just a joke? Because the people are actually really doing the work. Like, when the people are marching, they really are marching for something. So I always tell the celebrities, when you show up, make sure that you really are going with what the people are trying to protest for, or because we artists, we emotional, so we're automatically gonna say something emotional.
You're just gonna say something, right? Comes out.
Yeah, but right now the people don't need emotional, they need action. So you can't just make a statement, you know what I mean? Like, actually have to move with the people.
Mm-hmm. All right, thank you. Let's talk about the music too, because at the end of the day, you're a musician.
Yeah, yeah.
And I find that you always seem to find the right kind of ingredients that you mix up into a new thing. You know, you mix up different music styles, you mix up different culture styles, uh-huh. You work with like a different range of people. How do you find that mix?
Well, my background is jazz, right? So I came from Haiti when I was 10 years old. By the time I was 17, I was playing 12 different instruments. Now people be like, yo, man, that's crazy, man. How you learn 12 instruments? Yo, when you in the ghetto, man, ain't a lot of things to do. You know what I'm saying? Either you're going to be on the street corner, you know, or you're going to be hooping or figuring it out. But I always say, like, this is the best time to get the kid to absorb as much as you can. I wanted to be a battle rapper, so I felt like that was the coolest thing, so I became a wordsmith. And one day I was playing jazz in my school,
in an auditorium, and a jazz teacher saw me. She was like, how'd you learn these chords? Do you know what they're called? And I was like, no, I could just hear them in my head. And she was like, you're going to jazz class tomorrow. And I was like, jazz? That's for old people. I don't do no jazz stuff. And she was like, you're going to learn jazz. And she put me in jazz, and I fell in love with, like, Miles Davis, Thelonious Monk. And then I understood, like, jazz is just fusion. So the whole world evolves around fusion. And the reason why hip-hop can't die and will never die, because it's the new jazz. And people be like, what you mean? I say, it's the fusion. Like, this is the only form of music that we can take anything. I mean, last night, I was playing at the club, right in the middle of the club. I dropped a German carnival mixed with a Brooklyn carnival, all like within the same spot. This is what you could do with hip hop, you know what I mean? So for me, fusion is the most important thing.
But you make it sound so easy. And when you started, it was like the whole industry was much more rigid about like being real and like not crossing over to pop and like, and you still always like managed to find the right kind of mix. Is that the different cultures you grew up with or?
Well, I mean, I used to take a donkey to school, man.
Like, donkey?
Yeah, I always tell my daughter that and she'd be like, here go dad donkey story again. But when you come from where I come from, I took a donkey to school. I ate dirt from the floor. You
That's
feel
in
me?
Haiti. You're not talking Brooklyn here.
Nah, Haiti. Yeah. So when I got to Brooklyn, I got to the projects, man. I felt I was rich.
Whereabouts? Where did
Marlboro you... Projects in Brooklyn. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying to you? I felt like I was rich. Because to me, you know, one man's disaster could be another person's gain. Like, you don't know. So for me, I just felt like when I came where I came, it was endless opportunities. But we were the weird kids, you feel me? Like, coming up, it was like, they was like, yo, Wyclef is weird, dog. Like, he taking country music, mixing it with, and they used to be like, yo, that's not hip-hop. Mm-hmm. And they were like, oh, the Fugees is singing songs. That's not hip-hop.
Yeah.
They got to keep it real, man. You got to be an MC. You got to spit. Now, look at every kid is singing a hook. They're auto-tuned. They both, the Fugees was doing this in 1997. So for us, once again, I could always see it like 10 years ahead of where it's about to go. So now, check it out, man. I'm from the 90s, man. Where my man at with the two vinyls? This guy earlier, he had me sign two vinyls. He tripped me out. Is he here?
I think he's back. He's an
artist. Yeah, he had two vinyls, and it tripped me out because one vinyl was the score, and then the other vinyl was like the new album. And it tripped me out, and I was like, when the score came out, we had no YouTube, no Spotify, no Apple Music, no nothing, no streaming. And it's so funny to see how it goes from the vinyl to the streaming, like so much information in between. It's crazy.
It is crazy. And it's, I mean, 20 years, that's really a long time. Now you are about to release Carnival 3.
Yeah.
It's the first Carnival came out in 97.
Yeah, and that's not a Photoshop picture.
The second one came out in 2007.
Yeah.
And now it's 2017. Is there a reason there's 10 years in between?
I actually didn't plan it like that. I swear it wasn't a scheme. But you know, we got Godfather Part 1, Part 2, Part 3. Mm-hmm. Somehow they all go to each other. Carnival 1, Gone to November was the theme. Refugee All-Stars, that was the whole theme. Wyclef presents the Refugee All-Stars. Who the hell's the Refugee All-Star? It was bigger than Lauren Prize Forte. You're the Refugee All-Stars. It was like we were saying, at the end of the day, all refugees are stars. Carnival 2, 10 years later, the whole focus was the sweetest girl. And the video, me and Akon, right? I'm gonna tell y'all something. And when y'all see Akon, y'all can ask him. Akon was a barber, man. I know Akon from the hood,
mm-hmm.
You know, before convict music. And Akon used to always be like, yo, I'm doing music. So it was interesting. And Akon's on the score, nobody know. I put him on the last record, the remix to Fuji La.
Like, is he singing or is he rapping? Or
Nah, Khan is singing. So for me, the whole new direction on where I'm going with this new album is every kid that was 12 years old, listening to Uncle Wyclef, are producing for Drake, for Young Thug, all of that. Their albums is the Carnival and the score. These are the kids that came in the studio. So the album sounds like what happens when the uncles meet the nephew. So it literally, and it's a lot of stuff going on in the studio, because you know, I'm showing up with the old man guitar, the bass, you feel me? I gotta play the drum, man, you feel me? And you know, you got the laptop. What happens when you take the trap sonic, put it against the kit? So this is what the album sounds like. So it's like 1997 meets 2017.
In terms of sounds, like new sounds and new people.
Because the songwriting, we always gonna get the songwriting, right? But the sonics will change with every generation, right? So we from like the boom bap. So we would do the woodpecker, you know what I mean? The woodpecker, like you hear the music, you're like. That's how you know who from the 90s, right? My daughter don't do that. She don't even know what that is, right? She hears the bass different. So her whole generation is like this. You know? So, like jumping jacks. Like, what you doing, Angelina? But they hear the bass different. So in their generation, they chill. Okay, where's the bass drop? And the minute they hear the bass drop, they, you know what I mean? So the whole album is a combination of sonics, which what makes it incredible, right? So the trick is, how do you not piss off a fan from 1997, but still be current with your daughter, right? So to the fans from 97, I'm clear with y'all. I have not lost my mind. I'm not going, nigga, no one trapping. We're not trapping, nigga. Y'all be like, Wyclef done lost his goddamn mind. So no, but I got my little nephews for that. They trap all day, man.
Yeah, you gotta keep it fresh. Why the title, The Fall and the Rise of a Refugee?
The Fall and the Rise of the Refugee is just to let everybody know that it's okay to fall. And it's all right, man. Like, you know, because I came up with my peers, and the word refugee is a metaphor. Like, I was there with Whitney Houston in the studio. I was there when we did, like, I wrote My Love's Your Love. I saw her love for her daughter. And I put the mic in her, and she was like, sing, mommy. And I sampled that into the record, right? So for me, like, I think sometimes we give ourselves so much responsibilities that we measure success so high. When that doesn't happen, we feel like we failed. So basically what I'm letting everybody know is it's okay to fall, because the best part about falling is actually getting back up and keep it going. So whether if a kid is getting bullied, you know what I mean? Whether if somebody's like, yo, you know, I'm hiding my sexuality because boom, 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 there's absolutely nothing to be ashamed of. At the end of the day, it's one love, it's one world, it's one unity. And we want everybody to know, I know kids that blew their heads off through suicide, through different bullying in forms of school. All of that is because in society, we make it seem so bad, like when people fail, that because the only way to get true success is you have to fail. Because when you don't pass the test, you ready to take that test again and know how you're going to pass it. And that's the whole idea with the fall and the rise of the refugee. You will rise.
Yeah. I mean, I guess working with so many great names and stars, you know, I mean, I'm sure you've seen some people fall and rise, you know? I mean.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
I mean, I believe, like, in my career, like, I fell and rise in certain spaces. Like, when I was doing politics, it was crazy. Like, it was no joke. Like, you know, they came at me, like, I thought, they came at me like they rose the ghost of J. Edgar Hoover, man. That's how hard they came at me, man. So I felt like I was being pounded, like, all kind of lies. Like, yo, Wyclef stealing money? I ain't stealing no money from my... It's almost like you find yourself in a position where you're being distracted to defend yourself, opposed to constantly keep working. Then you ask yourself, damn, well, why the fuck am I doing this? But then you remind yourself, right? No good deed goes unpunished. You're supposed to be doing this. If the maker have given you so much, right? And at the end of the day, we all gonna pass. And the only thing our kids and our generations is gonna remember is what we actually do. Like, if you push the needle forward or not, that's all we remember in history. Like, if somebody pushed the needle forward. Other than that, you irrelevant in history.
But you have to be brave. I mean, a lot of people, especially in the States, and if you look at, like, hip-hop, you know, people just want to be famous. They don't want to like change things? Like, where do you find that bravery to actually go out there and like stand up for something?
Well, the thing is,
you put your success on the line, don't you?
It looks like that, right? Because to a human, right, what determines success, right? So if you're not on the Billboard charts, if you're not popping, if the kids, so now you're not successful, you fell off. I don't believe that. Like, if I believe that, I wouldn't be here. I believe, like, true success is measured by what you really accomplish. Now, this is no joke. My first album's blunted on reality, so you can go back. Sony gave me some money for the first album. We went back, and the first album, we telling the Ku Klux Klan, it's a new generation, and we're not gonna stand up for any of this negative shit. This is the first Fuji album. So for me, once again, your DNA is always tested by how you start.
I feel you.
Facts.
Give you a box for that.
Yeah, man. Feel me? For those that don't understand, a box is a pound. Like, black people do it, it's a handshake. Mm-hmm. And when they hear box, they're like, yo, how come Clef ain't pick up a box and get to this? I'm like, here's the box.
Who's on the album besides you? You said uncles and nephews coming
together.
Yeah,
definitely. So the album is incredible. We have these producers called The Knox, also Super Mario. For me, I love producers because as a producer, you don't really know because the producer is the weird one, like me. You know what I mean? We building Frankenstein in the basement. I was so excited to work with Emily Sandé. Mm-hmm. Me and Emily, we did a record called Carry On. She's so incredible. I was so excited. We also did a record called Trapa Cabana, where I mixed trap and salsa. It's a lot of crazy shit going on. So y'all, we have two records right now that are out. One is called Fela Kuti, mm-hmm. and the other is called What Happened to Love. You know what I mean? All fun stuff. Clef back on his bullshit. Fun stuff. They're gonna like it.
Is it just gonna be fun stuff, or is it also gonna be some?
It's fun because
things.
Hips Don't Lie was fun, but if you pay attention to the lyrics, you know what I mean. My rap. Go back and listen to the rap. I'm telling like the DEA. This is why Clef and Shakira, the Colombian Haitian connection. We ain't selling cocaine though today. We doing music. Mm-hmm. So I love to make people feel things in music, right? You're gonna feel different emotions, right? I love to make you dance. Then at times I love to make you wonder and think, you know what I'm saying to you? But for me, it's like when I listen to Bob Marley, like sometimes he just makes you wanna, you know? And then sometimes he makes you wanna just cool out and think of the state of the world. So there's two records that make you like go in that phase. One is called Borrow Time. So Borrow Time is a record that I did. Apple had sent a spaceship called Juno to Jupiter, right? And Juno recorded a bunch of sounds from space and brought back to Earth. Mm-hmm. Some people looking at me like, yo, Clef, are you still smoking crack? No, this is a true story. So what I did was I took the sonics of Jupiter, combined it with this song, and we created a new frequency. So on the album, when you hear a record called Borrow Time, it's gonna be the first time on Earth that Earth can hear a combination with the Wyclef song mixed with the sonics of Jupiter. So for me, and that record is just saying like we're on borrowed time. And the second record is me and Emily Sandé. And it's telling y'all carry on. No matter what's going on, pick up and carry on, because tomorrow will be better.
Who else is on the album though? Who's being featured?
I have a lot of young new artists. I have an artist by the name of Jazzy. There's another artist by the name of Hannah. Also another artist by the name of TJ Riley. Now keep in mind, the schemes of my carnivals, everyone who's on my carnivals who I discover end up blowing up later. On all my carnivals, right? Because when I was doing like Destiny Child, no one knew, like, this was before, you know what I mean? So they say you gotta go through Uncle Clef before you make it, you know what I mean? Even Justin Bieber, even if Justin Bieber's watching this, he already know. Justin shows up, he's like this small. Mr. Wyclef Jean, what's good, homie? I'm Justin Bieber. Can you give me a shout out for my Facebook, please, man? I got you, Justin, what we gonna do? You know, then I go back to the crib, you know what I mean? And I don't know what's going on. Then my daughter's like, I said, Justin! It's like, you know? So I made Justin take a video for her, and then I send it to her. And she was little, you know what I mean? And she love Justin, boom, boom, boom. And it's so funny, like now she's getting older. And I'm like, yo, where's the Justin video? She's like, I erased it. I was like, you 12 years old. She's like, could you get me a video of Usher now? I'm like, say, daddy's work.
I'm talking about borrow time. You might not want to answer. No, I think you'll answer that question. How old are you now?
Oh, I'm 47.
47.
Yeah.
How does it feel to be? All right. Hey, man. All right. How does it feel to be in the booth rapping 47?
I don't lie about my age, man, because you have to understand the new 40s is the new 20s. Like,
I know
it's
exactly
true.
What you're talking about, man.
But I'm saying in music, too.
Yeah.
Like, in music, too. Like, the people who dominate the music is an older generation. Like, I'm saying, like, at the end of the day, and that's all across the board, because being that we was raised in the 90s, when you take your art seriously, there's something which is called A&R, and also developing your craft, you know what I mean? So a real Wyclef concert is always going to be crazy. Like, you know, which rapper going to show up playing 7 instruments on stage? But the genesis of what I do, like when you say, like, I'm 47, how does it feel like to be in a booth, right? This is how I feel like to be in a booth. What if Martin Luther stepped in the room, never stepped foot in the balcony? What if they had a bulletproof car instead of a drop top for Kennedy? Malcolm X did this speech. What if I sat amongst the congregation? So when them boys scream, get your hands on my pocket, I fire shots at the assassins. Listen, Germany, ain't nothing new under the sun. What if I had put blank in Marvin Gaye's father's gun? What if y'all knew the truth before sending your kids to war? I told y'all the man don't care about Iraq, he cared about the oil. Now what if I could go back in time? I'll erase 9/11, dip to the Bahamas, and put Aaliyah's luggage in a 747. Then I'll dip to Paris, put all the paparazzi in a slammer, so that way that night they would have never chased Princess Diana. I'm a wordsmith, I'm from the hood, man, you know what I mean? So.
So, you know, in true hip hoppers, it's like when you hear Jay-Z, it's like Jay-Z is like Miles Davis. It's a muted horn. It doesn't. So as long as we stay authentic to who we are, wordsmiths are going to always be wordsmiths, you know, but you have to always keep up with the culture of the kid. You know what I mean? Because sometimes I ain't going to lie to you, like some of my legends I look up to. I go to that VH1 Honors, you know, and they be like, yo, what's good, Wyclef? And you know, they're from the 70s and I love them, you know what I mean? I'm like, yo, these are the idols I look at. And they're like, yo, Wyclef, listen, I'm gonna send you a track and I need some vocals, you got me? I like, man, I got you, man. Just send the track, man, don't kill me. And then you get the track and it's going on and on and on and on and on, and the beat don't stop until the break of dawn. A Wyclef, grab the mic and do your thing. Okay, you know? And I'm like, man, I love this dude, but this is gonna sound crazy. So you still gotta constantly keep up with the culture, yeah, and the time. Up. Very important.
Right, I feel you. Now, we're here at a fashion fair. So of course we also wanna talk about fashion, or let's talk about strategic partnerships and brand corporations as well, because that's important in today's music business. You can't do it by yourself. So to do that, I want to introduce the Vice President of Sony Music Brands Life Licensing. It's a long-ass title. His name is Lars Düysen, so please give it up for Lars to come up on stage.
Hello.
Right on, baby.
I definitely need to work on that title. We need to shorten that.
It's a very long title, but it's fine. Also, I have to check the time because we don't have so much time. I don't want to be rude, but that's why I'm going to the phone. How important has fashion and brands been for your career?
I mean, really, it's important in the sense of strategic partnership, right? So what you try to do is I've watched brands change, right? Because you from the era where dudes is like, yo, man, you get with a brand, man, you selling out, you selling the culture out, right? Now, the Fugees never believed in that bullshit. So the bottom line is you have to make sure that whichever brand that you rocking with aligns with your interests. What I love more about what I see today is brands have no choice. They are social obligations that they must take. So I feel like partnerships now is even more crucial. Like when you get a hot song and you can pop it through the right brand, it actually goes faster sometimes.
Let me ask Lars to this, because Sony is the label that's been working with Wyclef for a long time, but now also Sony or the label is taking care of brand corporations. Like, how does that look like?
Well, we start with the interest of the music consumer. That's what we're looking at first and foremost, you know, because we need to understand what's relevant to target groups, you know, and of course we are in constant exchange with brands. But I think really, you know, the most important thing to create authentic content is to spend time with the artist. And this is what Wyclef and I do, for example, and this is what makes me so happy, because when I met Wyclef in June in Cannes, you know, when he was on the Lions jury, I had the feeling that he had to be here at Bread and Butter. It makes me so happy that he's sitting now on the panel. So we spend time together. We talk about stuff. We talk about fashion. We talk about tech and innovation and what a partnership can mean to a release of a new album, you know? It's reach, it's about, you know, like presenting the idea maybe on different channels in a different context that would have never been, you know, existing without the brand partnership. So that's really, you know, what defines a real authentic and genuine partnership between a brand and an artist.
So, but what are you looking for in an artist so you can say, okay, this makes sense to make it actually happen? Which kind of, what kind of potential or what behavior patterns or what personality does an artist have to bring in order for you to say this really makes sense?
I really want to understand what thrills the artist, you know? What is he passionate or what is she passionate about, you know? When I spend time with Wyclef or when I'm working with Zara Larsson or Alicia Keys, for example, I want to understand, you know, what are they passionate about so that they don't only, you know, go into a partnership because of monetary motivations, because those artists don't need that anymore, you know, they got that. They want to understand how to engage with a target group on a genuine level. So Wyclef and I, we're talking about tech and innovation, for example. We're talking about automotives. We're talking about how can we combine, you know, like audio gear and fashion, for example, yeah? And I think at this point of time, it's just, you know, we are opening up the dialogue and we want to choose very carefully who is the right partner for us going forward. And it makes me extremely proud, you know, that Sony Music is not only, you know, the partner in releasing Wyclef's music, but also plays an important role in the brand partnership area.
Okay. I think we have a small video.
Yeah.
We want to show it real quick. And I want to ask you some more questions. And then also we're going to have some live music later, right?
Yeah, I came to play live. In just one day, these five individuals have taken in hundreds of brand messages. They participated in thousands of social interactions across dozens of platforms. They've thought infinite thoughts. They've had experiences that are unique to them and them alone. But there is one thing that they share. They all have a soundtrack to their lives. They are all music consumers.
Well, music lovers. Mm. So music still matters today.
That's dope.
Yeah. What are you looking for in a brand for you to decide to say like, yes, let's do it?
Just looking for a brand that thinks out of the box. Innovation. One that focuses on not what's present, but that could see what's 10 years from now. You know, so for me, that's always it, right? So music consumers, there's always a soundtrack to people's life. So as someone who creates soundtracks, you know, to people's lives, it's crazy. Just looking for a brand that understands, because Hips Don't Lie was done 2 years prior to it blowing up. But once again, it would take the right partnership. Yeah. Sony Music would have to get involved. And then the record goes from just normal to explosion. Once again, it's that brand partnership and how that's brought to the public.
Wow. How do you feel about playing some music?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Y'all want to hear me rock?
Are you guys ready? Yeah.
Enjoy, man.
We're going to have fun.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Lars Düysen. Okay. Give it up for Wyclef.
Yo, can I take this thing off?
Engineer, could I remove this piece? Is that okay? I don't want to mess it up. I'm going to go on the other mic, right? Is that all right? All right, let me see.
Yo.
You're right there. You need some assistance. You good.
Man, listen, good. When you're from the projects, man, you just make it work, man.
Huh? Okay, cool.
Okay, tell me how many minutes I got, man.
You got time for
5:40? Okay, so, let me give you our experience. This is how I write songs, okay? So I get a call from Clive Davis. He said he needed a song for Carlos Santana some 10 years ago. So let me give y'all my process how I write songs, okay? So I'm gonna run through a bunch of crazy stuff. Turn up the guitar.
Maria, Maria, yeah. She remind me of a West Side Story. Growing up in Spanish Harlem.
Okay.
She living life just like a movie star. Yeah, Maria, Maria, yeah. She fell in love in East LA. To the sound of the guitar. Yeah.
I was like, hey girl, I could see your body moving, and it's driving me crazy. And I didn't have the slightest idea until I saw you dancing. And when you walk up on the dance floor, nobody could not ignore the way you move your body, girl. And everything someone expected, the way you right and left it. So you could keep on shaking. I never really knew that she could dance like that. She make a man want to speak Spanish. That's what Shakira said about me. She's like, hey boy, when you talk like that, you make a woman go mad. So keep on rocking. And then I started writing, I was like, baby, no, I'm on tonight, you know my hips don't lie. I actually said my hips don't lie first, just so y'all know. Yeah, baila la calde de noche, baila la calde de día, baila la calde de noche, baila la calde de ready night. Here I come, or you can't hide now. I'm gonna find you and beg you on me. Yeah, ready or not, here I come. Oh, you can't hide now. I'm gonna find you and beg you on me. Yeah, thank you. So, yo, let's turn up like we did in a club last night. Let's play the brand new single. This right here is called What Happened to Love. When we say do the two-step, everybody got to do the two-step. You understand? So y'all want to turn up with me one time? You want to turn up, man? You want to turn up? Turn the music up, baby.
I'm just getting back from the tour.
Turn it up.
I got one thing to say, man.
Everybody get up, man. Please. Get up, man. Woo. Welcome to the party.
Bass man, are you with me?
Let's go.
That's my drummer. Get funky on him. Look at here. Your man's right here. Celebrate tonight like New Year. Let's cheers. Cause love's in the air. Jealous girls looking at you with the hate stare. You still got slang. You my boogie bang bang in the middle of the night when you do the wild thing. Baby, baby, love the way you ting-a-ling-a. It's so hot. Fire alarm. Ring-a-ling-a.
Hands up,
you
y'all.
Never have
you
to
don't
be
gotta
alone.
Be alone.
I swear that you're the only one. You know with me you found your home.
Let me get a little more keyboard, please.
One day, girl, we'll be looking back. I'll kiss you, then you
everybody
kiss me back.
Everybody have
with the two-step, everybody. This one right here is called What Happened to Love.
You know with me you found your home.
Yeah, with me you found your home. Let's go.
One day, boy, you'll be looking back.
You'll look back.
I'll kiss you then.
Y'all got a two-step with me. Y'all got a two-step with me. Please.
What happened to love?
Come on, everybody. Come on.
Boy, it's as good as it always was.
Thank you, everybody, for watching. Give it up again for Wyclef. For all of y'all, there one more. It doesn't have to stop, because Wyclef is going to do a DJ set at the Body Shift. That's at 3 o'clock.
Yeah,
so
3 o'clock,
the party
buddy.
Continues.
Okay, 3 o'clock, I'll see y'all. I'm going to bring some more records, and we'll have some fun. I got y'all.
Thank you very much for watching, and goodbye. Thanks, man.